fwd.com/heart. And we hope you enjoy the rest of your worship experience.
Well, good morning, Second Service. How are we this morning? Oh, come, that's awesome. I'll tell you, what a wonderful day it is. It's the Alabama heat. Everybody's melting as they walk outside. But you guys are so full of energy, and I absolutely love it. Well, my name is Chris. I'm proud to be the associate pastor here at Life Church. Pastor Brad is still with our mission team in Guatemala, and they should be back sometime tomorrow. They're having an absolute blast and a ball. We have so much stuff that's going on here. I do want to echo a couple things that you saw in the announcements just to make sure everybody is on the same page. If you are a first-time guest or if you're a new attender and you haven't made your mind up and maybe want some more information on the church, I want to encourage you to meet with our pastor next Sunday morning, 8 a.m. over in the coffee shop right across the street. It'll be just a very intimate time for y'all to talk. It's not signing people up. We're not going after. We promise not to give you any offering envelopes that day, but they'll come. But just a chance for you to talk with him and meet him and ask some questions if you'd like to. We have an amazing, amazing youth ministry here, Zion Youth Ministries. Our pastor, Pastor Curtis, that was just out here. They have lots of stuff still coming up. They're going to Six Flags. They're going to the beach. If you have a teen that is not signed up and not a part of this youth group, they need to be because they are missing out. Accelerate, our young adult ministry, is going to the ramp later in August for a conference. And if you need more information on that, see Sarah or Jay, Terry, and they can get you guys logged in. Listen, there's something for everybody. If you got nothing to do, it's your own choice, okay? So we just finished up VBS. Y'all know what that means, Vacation Bible School, right? Yes, okay, Vacation Bible School. Got to be a part of Vacation Bible School. You know, it's amazing what you can learn in VBS. Did you know, for instance, that, let me see if I can remember how this goes. Photons, protons, and neutrons. Photons. Photons are what the Enterprise shoots. It's protons. Protons, thank you. Neutrons, electrons all have mass. Did you know that? I didn't even know they were Catholic. That's where I am right there, so. That was a long way to go, wasn't it? Oh my gosh. All right, so anyway, we're finishing up today is our last in our series of Timeless. I get stuck with the last, I say stuck. It's an honor to be up here. I get to speak on the very last, it seems like, of our message series, and this one is no exception. This is a good one, though, because this one's personal to me. We're talking about timeless. We're talking about those foundational truths and those things that we need to build our lives on. So we started out, we talked about the Bible, the Word of God. Is it true? Can we trust in it? Can we believe it? We talked about salvation, what that means, how it affects us, how it should affect us, and what that means to us as believers. We talked about God. Can we believe in God? Can we put our trust and our hope and our faith in Him? Answer is yes, by the way. We talked about that last week, and today we get to talk about one of my absolute favorites. The title of today's sermon is Why I Go to Church. So here's the thing. I'm not going to tell you why you should go to church. I'm going to tell you why I go to church. But here's the importance of all this. Jesus tells us a parable in Matthew chapter 7 where he talks about these two builders. You've heard this parable before. He talks about these two guys that both build a house. But one guy builds his house on sand, and the other guy builds his house on a rock, on a firm foundation. Jesus goes on to tell us that these storms come, waves come crashing against these houses, and the one on the sand is washed away, but the one that was built on the firm foundation stands. That's the importance of going through messages like this, sermon series like this. We go back to those foundational truths because you know what? The storms are still raging, the waves are still crashing, and we need to be able to stand. Now, one thing in that parable that I love is the fact, in the original language that Jesus is telling us, both of those houses are the same. Same construction, same materials, same quality. The only difference was what they were built on. We see that played out in the world today, don't we? We go outside, we see people whose lives, people that we know, people that we love that are crumbling. People whose lives are falling apart. And we have to go back to that foundational truth. Those things that we build our lives on. Those things that we deem are important. So our verse for this morning, our central, our core verse is Hebrews 10. 24 and 25, and it says, let's think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works, and let's not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. I'll leave that verse up there for just a minute. You've heard this verse before, but here's what I want you to understand. He's saying right here, let's not neglect the meeting together as some people do. See, in first century church, the first century church, they believed that the neglecting of coming together for us in modern day language, not going to church was the beginning of apostasy. Apostasy is that falling away, that separating yourself from the things that you know are right and good, that you start wondering, you start guessing. Look at what's happened to us. Look at what happened has happened to us. There was a day, this is how old I am, there was a day when church was not an option. Not because it wasn't, well, do we go to Six Flags? No, because it was that important in our lives that was the only choice that we made. This is why church is important to me. It's seen me and it's seen my family through many storms, many trials, many tribulations. But it's that foundational truth that we need to come back to. That walking away leads to that apostasy. It leads to that doubt. It leads to us beginning to second guess things and beginning to set our own faith and our own desires up. Now, here's what I don't think. You can take that verse down. Here's what I don't understand, because I'm not a smart guy. I don't understand why they can tell us that there's a million inhabitable planets in the solar system, but you see a sign on the wall that says wet paint. What do you want to do? You want to touch it, right? I don't understand. Here's a good one. I don't understand why women open their mouth to put on mascara. That makes no sense to me. I don't understand why, if that little black box in an airplane is indestructible, why they just don't make the whole plane out of it. I don't understand. But here's something else. I don't understand why we, as Bible-believing, bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ, followers of Christ, have determined that church, that the meeting together, that us coming together under the blood and the banner of Jesus Christ, just isn't that important anymore. I don't understand that. There's a principle called the third place principle. Now, it's new to me. You may have heard of it before, but this blew my mind when I heard this. This was back in 1989, and there's a psychologist who determined that there are three places in everybody's life that are their sanctuary, their safe place, that place that's non-negotiable. And 1989, okay, home was first, and it should be. Work was second, and it should be. But it's that third place. That's the one that everybody's fighting for. That's the one that everybody is going after. When I was growing up, there was no choice. Third place was always church because that was right. Because we got to come together with people that we loved, people that we trusted, people that we knew loved the same God and followed the same God that we did. Let me ask you this for some of you guys with hair the same color as mine. Do you remember? I didn't say old. Do you remember? There used to be a day when businesses closed down on Wednesdays. Do you remember that? Because that was church night. It was church night for us and youth when I was growing up. All right, here's another one. Do you remember there used to be a time when businesses didn't open on Sundays? Do you remember that? It's because of church. Church was important. But we've taken our eyes off the prize. We've forgotten what's important, and we have let other things come in and take the place. Now, I want to show you a trick. When my wife and I, we've had the privilege of serving in ministry our whole married lives. We started out in children's ministry. It was, oh, my Lord God. I love Connie, and I appreciate her dearly for that. I would never do it again. But we went to youth ministry, spent many years in youth ministry where we saw God really do some incredible things, and then to young adults, college, and then whatever I'm doing now. But I learned these tricks because when you're trying to get kids' attention, if you got something that they're thinking about, you can pull them in with it. Or if you're doing street ministry, you can do a little trick and get somebody's attention. They'll stop walking and talk to you so you can share the gospel. Here's a trick. This is, by the way, this is one of the hardest tricks that I know how to do. This takes the most precision, the most concentration. I'm just going to have to ask for everybody to be completely quiet while I do this, if you would, please. Are you ready? Watch carefully. I'm going to take this ball. I'm going to place it in my hand like so. Then I'm going to reach into the hat. And I'm going to get the wiffle dust. And when I sprinkle the wiffle dust over my hand with the ball in it, and I count to three. One, two. Now, there's a purpose behind this. One, two, three. It's gone. Oh, y'all aren't nearly as impressed as I thought you'd be. I don't get it. What's wrong? That was good, wasn't it? All right, let me do it again. Y'all watch carefully. Oh, there's a purpose behind this. You ready? Watch very carefully. I'm going to take the ball. Are you watching? Watch very carefully. I'm going to take the ball. I'm going to put it in my hand like so. I'm going to reach into the hat. What are you grinning at? Where do you think the ball is? Is this my right hand? No, see, I put it, Y'all weren't watching. You weren't paying attention. See, that's the problem. We've stopped paying attention. We've taken our eyes off what we know is true. We've taken our eyes off the foundational truths that we know are secure, and we've decided we know better. We've decided we have figured it out and that our way is the best way, because who knows what I want better than me? We have taken our eyes off. We weren't paying attention. And that's exactly what's happened. That's why churches have become irrelevant in our society today. That's why we've become impotent. That's why people who are supposedly know more than we do look at us as backwards hillbillies and myth believers and fable believers, because we've lost our place. The problem is we've let it go. It wasn't taken from us. And it's time for us to come back to that place where the church is relevant once more in our lives and the lives of our families and in our community. It's time for us to come back to not being the silent minority, but being the vocal majority, the place where people can come for the answers, for the truth, for love, and for mercy. It's time for us to step back up. This is why I go to church. So if you got your notes, we're going to fly through this pretty quick. You ready? Point number one, why I go to church. The war is real. The war is real. It's a battle. And I think too many of us have forgotten that. Too many of us have taken our eyes off. We weren't paying attention. And we've completely been blindsided by the fact that we're in the middle of a war with an enemy after our families, after our children, after us, after our city, after everything that it can take from us. Look at what Scripture says. Scripture says, you guys got that? I'm sorry. Yeah, 1 Peter 5:8. It says, Thank you right there. Be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And here's what I want you to see in the Scripture right here. Because we think about the enemy blindsiding us. We think about the enemy like hiding and trying to sneak up on. That's not what this says. Our enemy is bold, and he is after us and our children. He's after our families. He's not hiding. He's right in the middle of everything that's going on, and he's not embarrassed or ashamed to roar out, to let people know he's there, and he's grabbing people left and right, because we've forgotten that the war is real. We've taken our eyes off. We've been deceived by what we think is right, what we think is good, what other people say we should do and shouldn't do, and we've forgotten that the war is real and our families are being claimed, and we're seeing damage in that every single day. The war is real. It's insanity for me to go up against an army. It makes more sense for me to go with an army, right? Doesn't that make sense? So why do we always oftentimes feel like that we're just going to go on our own? We're going to make our own choices and decisions, that I'm okay, I can do it without them. Why is it that we have let coming together as a church, as a body of believers? Now, you understand, I'm not talking about just the four walls, but the four walls are important. It's a place together. The church is you and I, whether we're in here or out there. Why has that coming together become so unimportant and unnecessary in so many lives? That's the question that I'm asking you this morning. I've had the opportunity and the privilege of going to Africa twice since I've been here at Life Church. Rwanda, Africa. The first time I was able to teach in some pastors' conferences and preach some of the villages. The second time I was able to preach in villages and preach in one of the churches there. At the end of the trip, this is great. At the end of the trip, our host missionaries would take us on a safari. Rwanda has this beautiful nature preserve full of all sorts of animals that you can imagine. It's just like Africa. It's like turning on the TV and watching. Y'all remember Doctari? Okay, good. One person does. Anyway, watching what you think Africa looks like. And so we're getting into this Jeep, and we're getting ready to go. And our guide is telling us of all these different animals that we're going to see. This. But the highlight of the tour, the thing that they were most excited about, was for us to be able to see one of the four male lions that they had there and their families. Oh, that sounds pretty cool, doesn't it? We had this one person, this is our first trip, one person on our team that got a little nervous about that. And they were like, so what do we do when we see the lion, if we find him? The guy says, well, stay in the Jeep. Makes sense. But that didn't help. So this person's like, well, what do we do if they get a little agitated and we disturb them and they get a little aggressive? Stay in the Jeep. Well, what do we do if the lion tries to attack us and wants to come get us? Stay in the Jeep. And then the guy proceeds to tell us that a lion won't see you and me when we're there in the Jeep. He sees the Jeep and he sees something bigger than himself and something stronger. Come on now, this is good stuff. Y'all hang in there with me. This is good stuff and I want you to get this. He sees the Jeep. That's exactly like this lion that's wandering around roaring and trying to snatch us. When you and I go off on our own, we're easy pickings. But when we stay together as the church, as the body of Christ, he doesn't see you and me. He sees the blood of Christ that covers us all and we can stand victorious and not a victim. That's good stuff, Pastor Chris. Thank you. Oh, my stars, my stars, my stars. You know, the devil is a liar. You're not going to hear that though on CNN. You're not going to get that Oprah Winfrey's Book of the Month Club. The world's going to tell you what you want to hear. It's going to tell you what's popular at the time. It's going to tell you those things that are going to draw you to whatever their cause is. The word of God doesn't change. The truth of God doesn't change. Those foundational truths, those are the things that we need to build our lives on. Those are the things that we need to put our hope and our faith and our trust in. Everything else is revolving and falling apart, but those things never change. Never change. That's why I've loved this series. I've loved Pastor Heather. You know, I don't know if you guys realize, some of these songs are pretty old. They're probably so old, some of y'all think they're new. But only Pastor Heather could bring something from 20 years ago and make it relevant today. I love that about her. But the point is the truth of the message of those songs is the same because it's about the same Savior and it's about the same salvation. And when you and I can put aside our differences, when you and I can set aside those things, that those petty things that separate us one from another and decide, you know what, we're all washed by the blood. We're all been redeemed. We're all part of the same family, part of a church, a belonging together, whether it's in the walls or outside the walls. That's when we start to see life change, not just in our lives, but in the lives of the people that we know and we love. The war is real, and we've lost too many people, and it's time for us to draw a line in the sand and say no more. From this point on, nobody else falls victim. Come together as the church. So number one, the war is real. Number two is there is strength and there is safety in numbers. Leviticus 26:8. Is that right? Yeah. Five of you will chase 100 and 100 of you will chase 10,000 and your enemies will fall by the sword before you. You see how this works, how this progresses? Like one's okay. One could do a pretty decent job. But the more there are of us, the greater the victory. When we come together, there's strength and there's safety in numbers. And we've forgotten that and we've gotten okay with going our own direction and fighting our own battles, forgetting that we've got a whole family of believers that are willing to stand with us and willing to fight with us. Look at Ecclesiastes 4:12. Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves, and a cord of three strands is not quickly broken. My son and daughter-in-law used this knot tying thing in their wedding they had recently. He wanted me to remind you that if you were not able to come, that's okay. They're still registered at Target and you can still get something for them. So, but we've heard these before. Why is it that we have become okay with being lone rangers? Why is it that we've become okay with branching out on our own and depending on our own strengths instead of the strength of the God who created the universe? Why is it that we've been okay fighting our own battles, marginally maybe, mediocratively. Is that a word, teacher? It is now. Instead of going to the one who created us and created us to be his. Why is it that we've become comfortable with that? When we were doing youth ministry, we'd always, this is Shark Week, by the way. Do y'all watch Shark Week? I don't. I mean, I like swimming in the ocean. Too much. We actually, so I say that, and we actually, our family had a shark encounter. Real true story. It was the last time we went to the beach, and it was me and my kids. I have three children. We were out in the ocean. This was, the first time we'd been to Gulf Shores where the ocean wasn't infested with jellyfish. So we're out there swimming. And so, no jellyfish. There's a shark. Go figure. So we're out this deep in the water, and we're just having a ball. And all of a sudden, I look up to the shore, and I see all these people doing this, you know, running towards the sand. Well, listen. You do that, you don't need to holler shark too. You know, everybody sort of figured out. You've seen Jaws, right? You sort of know what's going on. Everybody's doing this, running up the shore, and somebody's hollering shark, shark, shark. And my kids start to do this. I'm like, nope, stay together. And I'm staying behind them a little bit because I figure like the shark's going to get somebody who get the old slow one. And so anyway, I've got my kids going, but keeping them together. See, that's the lessons of Shark Week. If you watch those shows on Shark Week, who are the ones that get eaten? It's the ones that drift off. So it's the ones that separate themselves from the group. But the ones that stay together in that group, the ones that stay together in that unit, they're the ones that are telling us the story we're watching. The lessons of Shark Week. When you and I drift off, when you and I see somebody starting to drift off, we've got to reach out and grab them and pull them back in because there's safety and there's strength in numbers. And we've forgotten that the war is real. And that person's not just drifting off to do their own thing. They're drifting off to become a casualty. And it's up to us to be the ones to reach out and save them. So here's one more illustration. Sequoia trees. I'm told are the largest trees in the world. You can even drive a car through one. I've not seen them. But do you know sequoia trees have extremely shallow root systems? And so if they stood by themselves and there was a storm, they would blow over very easily. The reason sequoia trees stand and the reason why they're so old is because they interlock their roots with each other. So one sequoia tree doesn't stand by itself. It stands with the strength of all those trees around it. Oh, come on. This is good. Come on, y'all. This is good stuff. Y'all can amen if you want to. That was all right. Do I need to do another trick? There's strength and there's safety in numbers. And when you and I stand together, the enemy doesn't see you anymore. He doesn't see me. He sees the body of Christ, something bigger than it can attack. The war is real, and there's strength in numbers. Takes us to point number three. And I'm telling you why I go to church. I'm not going to tell you why you have to go to church or why you should. I'm going to tell you why I go to church and you can make your own decision. Band, if I could go ahead and get you guys to come back up. Number three is he meets us here. He meets us here. Matthew 18:20 says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, I'm there with them." Think of the power. We're not talking about somebody. We're talking about the Savior of the universe who has promised that when we come together as a group in his name, he is with us. Why are we not praying down the enemies that we're facing? Why are we not praying down the obstacles that our families are facing? He's here with us. That's why I go to church. Now, I've heard it said 100 times, you have too. Oh, I can worship God on the golf course. I can worship God in the bass boat. I can worship God in the deer stand. And oh, yeah, you can. But let me ask you this. When was the last time you got in your bass boat specifically and strictly only to worship God? When was the last time you climbed in that deer stand with the sole purpose of only worshiping God? See, there's other distractions always. But when we come together, that's the importance of having the four walls, though the four walls don't make the church. That's the importance of having the four walls because it gives us a place to come together, hopefully distraction-free, where we can hear the word of God. There's a great story in the Old Testament where God comes to Jacob and he says, "Jacob, I want you to go to Bethel so I can speak with you." And Bethel means the house of God. Even way back in the Old Testament, God recognized and showed the importance of us coming to his house for him to speak to us. That's why I go to church. It's because he's here and he meets me here. And this is where I can find people that love me as ridiculous as I can be and that I can love and people who will stand with me and my family when I need them and that I can stand with when your time comes that you need somebody. He meets us here. And some of us need to stop running today. Some of us need to quit flailing our arms and we need to just come back into the family. We need to come back into his presence and we need to surrender ourselves once again. See, he's here because he tells us that he's here. So that means if you're here this morning and you're broken, you can find healing. If you're here and you've never met him, he's waiting to meet with you. The importance of us coming together is because he's here. Now, I know you're probably sitting there thinking, well, we are here, so why are you talking to us? Well, here's the problem I have with that. And first off, I appreciate y'all being here. Thank you. If you're watching by live stream, we love you. If you need to stay home to watch this because of health or safety, we honor you for that. But if you got no other reason, you need to come to church. Just saying. Here's that problem I have. Statistically, a regular attender of church, somebody that's considered a regular attender, is somebody who goes at least two times a month. Two times a month. We didn't have a choice when I was going up. And it's not the fact that, it's just there was nothing else for us to choose because that was what was bought for us. To meet somebody who only comes twice a month, that's a 50-50, right? That's not coming to church because you find relevance and meaning. It's coming to church because your football team's not playing today or because it's raining and you can't go fishing. But when you and I come to that place, we understand he is here and he is ready to do business with us today and that we are stronger together than we are when we're apart. Then it becomes important. And it becomes that foundation again that we build our houses on, our families on, our lives on. This is why I go to church. And I'm not telling you why you should go to church. I'm just telling you why I go to church. So this morning, as we get ready to close, I just want to encourage you. You ask God to show you. Everybody's here for a reason. And everybody has some business to do. You ask God to show you. Let me pray for you before we conclude this morning, and then we'll wrap things up. Father, I thank you for your love and your mercy and your truth. I thank you that you're a God of goodness, and I thank you that you're a God who meets and longs to meet with your people. Father, my prayer this morning is that you will either start a fire, that you will rekindle a fire, that you will blow on the flames that are in our hearts, Father, so where we long to be with you, to where everything else becomes secondary, but our relationship with you. And then we see how that plays out in our lives. We see our marriages come back together. We see our addictions broken. We see our children come back to you and come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Father, that's why I go to church, is because I know that you're here. And I know that in that example, I can lead my family in the same way. And I'm proud to say that today, standing up here, my three children are in church and serving somewhere. That's why I go to church. And if it's not important to you, I'm begging you to find a reason to make it important. Ask God to show you. As Heather leads us out with the final song this morning, I want to challenge you. We can talk about how bad things are, and we can talk about what we need to do. I'm so tired of talking. Let's do something. Let's make a choice today. You for yourself, you for your family. Make a choice today that either God's going to be my God or I'm walking away. Is that too bold? Is that too harsh? Jesus said, lukewarm water, I'm going to spit it out. Joshua said, choose this day who you will serve. But for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. Let's stop playing Christian and let's be Christian. Let's stop acting like a church and let's be the church. That's my challenge to you this morning. Love you guys. I hope you still love me. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. Where's Heather?
I am so honored that you have taken a few minutes out of your busy schedule to join us via technology in our online campus. And I want to give you a personal invitation to not just join us online, but actually join us in person. Our Coleman campus meets at 9 and 11, located there just off exit 299 south of Coleman. And then our Hartzell campus meets at 8:30, 10, and 11:30 every single week, where we would love for you and your family to connect in, to be a part of a local body of loving and caring people. There's something for absolutely every age group. And if we can serve you in any way, form, or fashion, drop us a comment there in the comment section. We would love to pray for you. We would love to be a part of the journey that Christ has you on as we're all just trying to live life forward as followers of